Last time we discussed about the perspective, about historical perspective and trends in VLSI design. In that part of that 2 or 3 hours, I discussed with you one of the major requirement of digital system these days is called high performance circuits. And high performance circuit, and the other one we said low power circuit, and then low standby power circuits. This particular lecture of today, which I am going to now go on for next hour plus, I am going to discuss something, how to design this so called high performance circuit, which essentially means fast CMOS circuits. We still believe that CMOS circuit will be going to be continue to have some kind of vehicle for any digital system for many more years to come. Now, this topic particularly which I chose today, a way of designing fast CMOS circuit called logical effort. Now, why this kind of method I am suggesting? As an analytical person, many of you probably are not, most of you are right now designing things on computer using CAD tools, but when you are designing a chip on a CAD tool, using a CAD tool, please be remember that there has to be some initial, some kind of a back of the envelope calculations done by you to get typically which kind of design one should use to get the required performance. And the starting point essentially is to be done mostly in analytical way. So, this part of the lecture essentially talks about how to design or start designing circuits for high performance and do it little analytically, and the effort which is shown here is called logical effort. Before I start, I must tell you that this I wish to acknowledge many of the people who has helped me to get to this topic. There are three people whom I want to actually thank, or rather salute them. They are Ivan Sutherland, Bob Sproul and D. Harris for their great logical effort. Actually, they I salute them simply because they wrote a book on logical effort way back in 99-2000, and that is the source of today's lecture. I received this, maybe it is interesting to know that I received this first version of the book from the website of late 90s before its publication itself. One of my colleagues at Stanford actually forwarded me the link, and I could read this book, read this part of the book then, and was extremely impressed how to do a design analytically for a high speed circuits. I also wish to thank the one of the same author of the book, which is D. Harris. He along with Bob Merman actually gave the first such course on the on this logical effort in their course at Stanford, and I have been happy, I mean lucky that I could get some of their slides. The third and the important book which I normally refer for my digital design book is by John Rebe of UC Berkeley. He along with Dr. Chandrakasan from MIT and Nikolic from Berkeley, they have written the book on digital integrated circuit design, published by Prentice Hall, and in their chapter 13 they have also have talked about some part of the logical effort, and they just gave the word effort there. Of course, there is very concise way they wrote there. This particular lecture probably expands it much more than what is written in this book. I am also thankful to many of my postgraduate students of my VLSI design course in last 25 years. They kept asking me many queries when I taught these courses, and probably that has improved my fundamentals to a great extent. To start this talk, I have outlined for my this lecture. I will start with introduction, to some extent I already gave you. The logical effort estimation of gates will follow, and then I will talk about FOX, amplifier chain of stages, branches and logical effort for other circuit families, and finally, I will give some concluding remarks. Now, let us say you are a chip designer, and if you want to design a chip for a given system, you have a bewildering choices to make. This right side photograph shows your difficult situation in which you are put to before you decide what to do. So, what is the what are the queries one gets into? So, what is the best circuit topology for the function you wish to implement? How large should be the transistors to actually give the performance? And how many stages of logic will give the least of the delay? Now, these queries are not very easy to answer in many cases. Many of us actually go on the using CAD tools, you have a schematic created, and start putting initial values of some width to length ratio of each transistors and start doing circuit simulations. You can see when you do such kind of this, tweaking a value is never a accurate way of doing things, because it may take larger time or it may never actually converge to a correct solution. So, where to start, even that is very crucial, and even if you are using a CAD tool. This logical effort is a method of answering many of these questions. What it does, it uses a very simple model of delay, then it allows you to do a back of envelope calculations, and therefore, it is much easier to tractable optimization. You can always do some kind of optimization, because it is much, it is an analytical function at your hand, and then gives new names to old ideas to emphasize remarkable symmetry. So, it is not that this idea of generating design method using logical effort is very different from what we were doing all the time, but this is slightly a modified and better way of doing the same thing. So, who cares about logical effort? In my opinion, these though people who are circuit designers, and they many a time they waste too much of time simulating and tweaking circuits, and therefore, they should first start with logical effort work, so that they do not have to waste too much time. Then the people who work on high speed logic design need to know where time is going and in their logic, which part of the logic has largest delay, and therefore, to get the critical path in the system, this method may help quickly to know which is the critical path, or even in a particular path which block is giving the slowest propagation and hence contributing to larger delay. And finally, of course, the CAD engineers need to understand circuits to build better tools. I am always of the opinion that a CAD tool designer should be a good circuit person, because only then he can appreciate the problems in circuit and then can create a tool which is much more stronger in actually applications of any circuit designer. Here is an example, of course, taken from Harris lecture. Ben Biddle is the memory designer for a Motorola 6886, he is designing a chip 68W86, which is an embedded processor for automotive applications. Now, typical some part of the circuit is shown below, and now what is query is it, help Ben design the decoder for the circuit shown here. Now, if you see a typical circuit, we have a 4 to 16 decoder to a register which actually drives the register file, which is 32 bit wide and 16 bit depth. So, which has essentially meaning 16 word register file, each has 32 bit width. Each bit represents a load of 3 unit size transistors. True and complemented input of address bits are available. Each input may drive 10 unit size transistors. So, Ben need to decide what can this requirement for this design is, how many stages to use, how large should each gate be, and how fast can the decoder operate. Now, basically when I talk about the speed, you must appreciate that the speed is decided by the propagation delay, that is the signal going from input to the output. How much time it takes, that decides essentially the speed. Speed means essentially 1 upon the delay is equal to the frequency of operation, and since we are putting a data at a given rate, this maximum rate with which data can enter is decided by this clock frequency, or this decided by this the highest frequency available. Now, here is a simple inverter shown. So, what is the inverter shown? You have a transistor, two transistor, one the p channel transistor, the upper transistor, and you have n channel transistor M 1, which is connected in a complementary mode. Now, if I give an input at V in here, to which is common to both p and n channel as a complementary input, and this is my output node. Now, this output is connected to its load, maybe a similar inverter or maybe a different inverter or more than one such inverters, which is called the fan out or the load of the circuit, through a wire which brings this output signal from the first inverter to the load part. So, what essentially we are now saying, that when the input changes, how fast this output will change, because the change in this node voltage can be decided by the capacitive charge stored from the at this node. So, one will looks into actually the what is the net capacitance this node is actually seeing when input is changing or input is actually given to this input A. Now, how do we calculate the capacitance? So, we go back to theory of transistors and we look into this fact very carefully. We say, okay, since there is a MOS transistor, and in a MOS transistor you have a gate capacitance associated with the oxide capacitance, and also you have a parasitic capacitance between gate and drain, gate and source, gate and drain. Similarly, for n channel there is a capacitance between gate and drain and gate and source. There is also a capacitance which is p-n junction capacitance associated with source and drain, and there is a capacitance which essentially we call drain to base, drain to substrate or bulk capacitance, and drain to source to this capacitance. Since there are so many capacitances associated at this node, one has to then find the net capacitance. So, there is a capacitance CdB2 and CdB1 coming from these two transistors at this node. Then there is a capacitance associated with the wire. Wire means any interconnect line between this node to the next load will have some capacitance, and this capacitance is associated, is we call it interconnect capacitance Cw. Finally, since you have a some kind of a load whose input will be capacitive in case of MOS technology based systems. So, there will be some input capacitance of this stage, which essentially in this particular case it to gate to source capacitance, gate to source capacitance of both n channel and p channel, and essentially one is talking about the capacitance of the gate oxides. Now, if this net capacitance here, which is the load for you, plus wiring capacitance plus the CdB2 plus CdB1 at this, the net capacitance is sum of all these capacitances, and that is the load which this inverter is seeing. Now, unless you compute all of them, one cannot see whether the capacitance will charge how fast or how slow it will discharge or how fast it will discharge. So, change in this node voltage potential at the input changes can only be known what is the value of this capacitance and what is the currents these circuits are able to provide for charging or discharging. Now, I will just give you the idea here, how do I calculate each capacitance before we proceed further. Let us assume right now all devices, all device capacitance are lumped into a single capacitor CL. So, point I am saying, this plus this plus this, all of them together I call it a load capacitance. Assume that input Vin is driven by an ideal voltage source, that is at this point I can give a step input voltages 0 to 1 and 1 to 0, or 0 to VDD and VDD to 0. Now, and assume that is a step source. Now, we have a composite CL, you know, this plus this plus this. So, we want to know the net capacitance coming out of it. Okay. The first capacitance you see from here, this is called CGS or CGD. Similarly, this is for input side. Obviously, this also is relevant, but for output side calculation, these capacitances do not come into picture simply because they are not connected at this node, but they may be connected to the, if these are driven by some other source. For this source, they may act like a load for them. So, we proceed ahead, we say, okay, here is an inverter driving this capacity load CL, in which there is a CGS, CGD, CGS and CGD as the two capacitances. These are called gate to drain capacitance, and the other is, the idea behind is, if there is a channel existing in the transistors, basically what we say, the gate to channel capacitance can be divided into two parts. Half of it we will say going to the drain side and half of going to the source side. By similar logic, if this is the n channel transistor, half of the capacitance is lumped at the drain side, half of that is lumped to the source side, and we calculate this CGS and CGD, both CGS values. Please remember, this is a source of a p channel transistor, this is source of an n channel transistor. The drain capacitances are actually drain to bulk or drain to this are not taken care, because they do not appear in this node. Okay. Now, this CGS and CGS for p channel and n channel will act as net sum, which is appearing here. Then there is a diffusion capacitance due to drain to bulk capacitances. You know, after all, there is a diode, p-n junction diode sitting between source and the substrate and drain and the substrate. and since these are reverse bias junctions, they will contribute to a junction capacitance. So, that is called diffusion capacitance CdB, CdB and CdB 1 for n channel and p channel. And finally, there is a capacitance, and of course, this you can think of this, they are essentially decided by something we call a model, which is called linearity model k, which has a factor k equivalent, which decide how much is the junction capacitance, how much is the junction capacitance associated, because we know at different biases the junction capacitance will vary, because the depletion layer will vary, and because therefore, we must evaluate the capacitances at given biases during the transition here. Of course, this has been done already in earlier notes of ours, but if you really want to know more about, please look for Ashrangian West book or any other book on digital CMOS VLSI design and find out how to calculate CdB or any device book for that matter. Then there is, of course, as I said, is the wiring capacitance Cw, which depends on width. Please remember, any width and length of the wire epsilon A by D, if you see a capacitance, the width of the wire and the length of the wire will decide essentially the, because the thickness is fixed, which is the oxide capacitance thickness of the field oxide, and therefore, it was not much different from the other side, only width and length of the wire may decide the wiring capacitance. Longer the wire interconnect you are moving, flowing, larger will be the capacitances associated. Okay. So, please remember there is a wiring capacitance, there is a capacitance due to the input of this stage, which is your load stage, and there is a output capacitance coming from your driver stage. This is the inverter which is driving this load and is connected by a wire. Please remember, this is called fan out. This is only one inverter shown or one gate shown. There can be more than one such gate where this nodes is connected down, up or many more, and is called fan out. So, larger the fan out, obviously the load capacitance will also increase. Now, how do we calculate the different capacitances? We know capacitance is delta Q by delta V. So, we can calculate the junction capacitances using simple p-n junction theory. We may assume the p-n junction is to be abrupt, or you can say step other kind of junction which is linearly graded or otherwise, and from that we can calculate some constants, and therefore, we can evaluate to some great extent the capacitances of the junction at different voltages. So, I can calculate Cj of the junction and therefore, at different voltages, and therefrom I can get Cdb2, and by similar logic I can get this. Please remember the capacitances here, which is the capacitance between gate and source and gate and drain, if you see very carefully, these capacitances are essentially given by, as I say, they are lumped capacitances half here and half here. And one can say it is nothing but the oxide capacitances of each. So, K s epsilon naught, or rather K epsilon 0 epsilon S I 2 by T ox into half half, we are half on the this drain side, half on this drain side. The net capacitance is called C g d, which is also equal to the source capacitance. This is half of epsilon 0 epsilon I 2 by T ox into area, of course. And using this, area is W into L, that is the width. Obviously, these capacitances, all of them are proportional to the width of the transistor. Now, switching response, you know, if you want to find out the switching response, what I actually start talking about switching response shown here, there is an input pulse given to the circuit shown already by me, and based on that input circuit, I am going to actually try to tell you how the currents will flow. For example, if this is my inverter, this is my p channel in transistor, this is my n channel transistor, and this is my V in, okay, input V in, and this is my output, this is my V 0, and it is essentially, I say, all of it, all the capacitance lumped at the output is CL. So, this is P channel, this is N channel, let us say this is W by L of P, this is W by L of N is available to known to us, and because of that we can evaluate the currents. Now, if you see the response initially, let us say when you say at t is equal to 0, V 0 is 0, therefore, VCL is 0. So, what does that mean? It essentially means that this transistor, n-channel transistor, may be fully turned on, and unless this is fully turned on, this node voltage cannot go to the ground. So, obviously, if this voltage is going to be ground because of the CMOS action, when n-channel was fully conducting, the p-channel must not conduct. Is that correct? It must not conduct. So, obviously, initially p-channel was not conducting, n-channel was fully conducting. So, essentially, you were at this point when Vin was high, making n-channel fully conducting and p-channel switched off. When I go the step down from V high to V low, as it is, let us say V low is 0 in our case, in case of CMOS, and V H is normally V D D. So, what we say that when V in goes to high to low, initial condition is T is equal to 0, V 0 is 0, therefore, no charge across the capacitor. When the input switches down, obviously, at the gate of P channel you see a voltage 0, and whereas you see a gate at the N channel you get see a voltage 0. So, obviously, transistor T n turns off. Whereas T p turns on, call this T p is upper channel turns on. On means it is conducting. So, obviously, during the transition, this input voltage is changing from high value to a lower value. And at the start of that value, what is VDS for P channel transistor? The VDS for this channel is essentially VDD, V 0 minus VDD, because this is the drain and this is the source of a P channel. So, V 0 minus VDD and V 0 was 0. So, obviously, this voltage is very high. Any decrease in V in towards 0, the V in minus V s, which is the VGS. So, VGS minus VT starts actually increasing, but at that time initially when you are going down, this is a smaller value, you subtract it out of VT. So, this is even smaller, this voltage across drain to source is very high. So, device enters TP starts in saturation, in sat mode, transistor is saturated. Okay. Whereas, when if it is in saturation, we know the current of a p channel device in saturation, but as the current starts moving coming from here, it starts, since n channel is switched off, we believe, of course, not all of it, initially we may say all of it, but in reality some current may go through n channel. So, this power supply through p channel now provides you a current to charge this capacitance to a higher value of voltage. Essentially means, if I plot V 0 versus T, initially voltage starts rising as the current starts charging the capacitor. There will be a time when V 0 becomes sufficiently high, V n is already 0. You can see the V G S now is very high, V G S minus V T is high, whereas V 0 minus V D D is coming down because V 0 is increasing. At that time, after certain value, say let us say here, the device then, this was sat portion, and then we say ahead of this, the next part is due to non-saturated P device. So, device enters non-saturation, and then you have a non-saturating current, which is function of V 0 and which starts charging, and finally, of course, asymptotically it reaches to V D D. And a time taken to reach to VDD, we call as the rise time 10% to 90%, as we shall show you later. And we say the switch has occurred, input has gone from high to low, output has gone from low to high. Now, this is called charging transient. By similar argument, one can see from here, when you have an input low and you give a transient, sorry, V low is 0, and you go to VH, which is essentially VDD. So, initially V 0 was at VDD, but at that time this transistor was fully on. As soon as the output input rises to VDD, P channel switches off, N channel turns on, and the charge on this capacitor, which is CLVDD, now starts discharging through this n channel, which is turning on. Now, what is the status in which TN turns on? Because at initially it was at 0, so transistor was off. Then when Vin exceeds Vt, n channel turns on, but VGS minus Vt is still very small, VDS is very large, VDD minus 0 or slightly less than VDD minus V0. So, obviously transistor again n channel also wakes up in saturation, and once it starts saturating, as this capacitor start discharging, the V0 keep falling and VDS of n channel start reducing. And since Vin has already reached to VDD, there will be a point when VDD minus 0 minus VTN is larger than V0 minus 0, which is the VDS, and then the transistor will finally enter non-saturation. So, in both cases, the initial rise or initial fall is because of the transistors are in saturation, and the next when it actually halfway down or not halfway, maybe one third way down, both devices, both in the case of charging, the p channel enters non-saturation, and in the case of discharge transient, n channel transistor goes into non-saturation after a while. Now, this is called transient response, and the time taken essentially reflects. So, now if you see a current of any n channel transistor or a p channel transistor, one can see from here what is the current one can get. Typically, current in a MOS transistor can be given by, let us say, n channel first, mu n C aux W by L of n channel V G S minus V T n into V 0 or V D S minus half V D S square. This is when VGS minus VTN, VTN is greater than VDS. So, for this condition, we know transistor is said to be in non-saturation, channel exists in a MOS transistor. Let us say this is n channel shown here, this is a P substrate, this is your gate oxide, and this is your gate, and this is your VDS, and this is your Vs, ground source is normally grounded, okay, and you are applying VGS here. So, obviously, if the channel exists throughout, okay, VGS minus VDS must be larger than VT, which essentially means VGS minus VT must be larger than VDS, channel exists throughout, and we say device is in non-saturation. However, if I keep increasing VDS, for a given VGS as well, then it may occur that at some point of the time VGS minus VT will be less than VDS, and if that occurs, the channel at this end will get pinched off, and if you further increase it, channel point will move on the left side towards source, and you say you are in saturated region of the transistor. So, since the currents in the case of non-saturation is shown here, only I am showing right now for n channel alone, mu n C aux W by L for n channel, and then we say it is V G S minus V T whole square, because we say V G S minus V T is much smaller than V D S, V G S minus V T is, V D S is much larger. And at some point, for a given VGS minus VTN is we call VD sat, a fixed value at which transistor will enter saturation, and then half VDS square, VD sat square minus half VD sat square, which is essentially reconverted back to VGS minus VTN square. Now, the point I am trying to make, if I want capacitor to charge or discharge faster from the current point of view, if I had to charge faster, I must provide you larger current, and if you want to discharge, I must also provide larger discharge current, and the currents are proportional to size, okay. And of course, they are way, if it is n channel, it is mobility is larger than p channel device, because mobility ratio is larger. So, we see now that if I want to improve the charging transient or the discharge transient, one method of doing is to increase the sizes. Is that clear? Whenever transistor has a size, and transistor normally, if you see a IV characteristics of a transistor carefully, if you see a transistor characteristics, IDS versus output characteristics of a transistor, IDS versus VDS. So, you can see for a given VGS, it is something like this. For a different VGS, it is different kind of thing, VGS increasing. Okay. So, what we are trying to say you that up to this, for example, device is in non-SAT mode and beyond this somewhere here is SAT mode. If you see the resistance on this side and if you see resistance on this side of the transistor, IDS delta IDS by delta VDS to the minus 1 is the resistance of transistor R on. So, obviously, if you see R on, this in non-saturation the device has much smaller resistance, whereas in the case of saturation the resistance is very, very high, extremely high in fact. So, correspondingly R on if you see in a transistor, and since the transistor acts like a resistor, we can see from the figure now, we go back to the slide here shown here. I am now talking as if both charging and discharging transient acts like you have a voltage source, you have a transistor resistor, equivalent of transistor is replaced by resistor both for discharge and charge. Charge it will be p channel transistor resistor, in discharge it will be n channel equivalent resistor, and this is the load. So, how do I charge or discharge a capacitor, particularly if I am charging it? V out is 1 minus e to the power minus t by tau, this into V finally. So, we now figure it out, the charging transient essentially decided by the tau, which one can say typically the delay time associated is 0.69 RC, propagation delay. So, what essentially is trying to say, tau is time constant RC. So, and if you solve this, one can say the proper time taken to transmit signal from here to here is ln 2 into this. This is approximation because currents are not linear, but assuming that so in the this case is true. So, one can say if I want to improve the speed, which means the propagation delay I want to reduce, R and C should go down, but C is increasing because that load is not known to me. So, if C is larger or not known to me, only way I can change the speed is by changing the R. If I want better this, R should reduce. And I just now said the on resistance of a transistor is smaller if the size of the transistor is larger. So, one can now get from this simple calculations that all that we are now trying to tell you is that if I want to improve the speed of the inverter, both resistances of n channel and p channel should be correspondingly reduced at a given input voltage for a given load such that the propagation delay time is minimized. The figure here, I think having shown you, figure here shows now a transient response of an inverter. A switching response, this is my input versus time, I am giving a pulse, input pulse, and I figure out that even after I give my input starts rising, it takes finite time before the p channel output start falling down by simple reason that there is an input capacitance also needs to be charged before this will start responding. Now, once it start n channel start turning on when the input is rising, initially input low essentially means n channel is off and p channel is on, the output is high. Now, input is rising, as input rises the n channel turns on, p channel turns off, and because of that I can say the voltage at the output as we discussed just now keeps falling. Now, the definitions of these is essentially like this. The time taken from 90% to 10% of output from higher to lower is called the fall time. By similar logic, when you are going from high input to lower input, we say when the input rises from 10% to 90% in the charging transient, that is called rise time. But we define two other important terms, which we say TPHL and TPLH. We say 50% point of the input to the 50% of the output, The time delay is called TPHL here, and for the charging transient, 50% of the input to the 50% of the output we call TPLH. This we already discussed, all of you know very well. This is very well done in the Ishrangian's book as well as it is given in Rebbe's book. So, you do not have to this, but since it was a again a video course, I thought I will repeat it what I did earlier in the case of this. The net delay one can see from here, average delay one can say, not net. If the total signal has to cross the inverters, you have to go through an average delay of TPHL plus TPLH. Average means TPHLH plus TPLH by 2. So, we say on an average a signal will pass, one bit of signal can pass in a delay time which we call propagation coefficient TP, which is nothing but average of TPHL and TPLH. So, if we reduce both TPHL and TPLH, obviously my TP will decrease, and therefore, the circuit will become faster. Now, how to compute capacitances? Here is something interesting things I have shown you. CGD1 is 2 CGD0, CD0 essentially stand for capacitances per unit length. So, if we multiply it by width, then it becomes CGD1. If I multiply by p channel transistor width, then it becomes CGD2. Then these are the junction capacitances, this is junction constant as I derived in my last slide. A is the area, P is the perimeter of this transistor area, I mean on the surface, and one can then evaluate both junction capacitances CDB1 and CDB2. If you want to know what is the capacitance at the input CG3 and CG4. Essentially, it is oxide capacitance, net oxide capacitances. So, C ox is capacitance of oxide per unit area multiplied by area, which is Wn into Ln. By same argument for a p channel, it is C ox Wp into Lp. And of course, wiring capacitance decided by the technology used and the length of the wire you are using. So, you need to extract from the circuit layout what is the Cw value. And finally, the CL, the net capacitance, is sum of all of these. Now, here is another issue in the transient one looks for. So, one can let me go back again slightly. So, if you see this capacitance once again, so obviously, if I reduce the capacitance in RC time constant, then the speed will improve. So, to improve speed, one must look into the area term, the width area essentially come from Wn. So, essentially the dimension of the transistor W and L, they actually decide what is the kind of speed the circuit is going to have. And a priori, do we start with the minimum area transistor W equal to L equal to the feature size, or do we start with some numbers which is more closer to the expected value of TP and therefore, can make the guess where to start. Our today's effort is to show you how to guess these initial values of W and L. Okay. Now, another issue which many of us are worried about in the case of CMOS circuit is what we call as switching thresholds. Now, why are we worried about switching threshold is the following. A typical inverter character output characteristics or transfer characteristics is shown here, input against output. For different value of beta and beta p and beta, and beta of course, as I say in my calculations, if I have not shown you somewhere, I may repeat in my all of my calculations, beta is mu C ox W by L. Obviously, if it is n channel, I will call beta n is mu n C ox W by L, beta p is mu p C ox W by L of p and W by L. Obviously, if I define my beta ratio as beta n by beta p, from these two expressions, one can see that if C ox is same and the mobility ratio of n channel to p channel and the surface mobility ratio is 2 typically. To make beta n is equal to beta p, the size of p channel must be double that of size of n channel, and that is very important. This is called beta r of 1 means beta r of 1 means beta n is beta p, assuming mu n is 2 mu p, we say W by L of p is twice that of W by L of n. So, one can see from here that the if I change a beta ratio, I am now seeing the transfer characteristics is moving from one end to the other end, and what is the importance of this transfer characteristic? One can see from here the point this characteristic starts falling at this point when beta r is 0.1, this characteristic is say beta r is 0.5. So, what we see beta r, as I increase beta r, the transfer characteristic starts moving. Now, what is the importance of this region, the where it falls from high to low? This is called a point at which transistor goes from high to low and is the most important characteristics of any inverter. This is called the point at which it actually falls down, is essentially called inverter threshold. Now, one can see inverter threshold is say for 1 it is somewhere here closer to 50% of VDD, whereas if I reduce beta ratio further, I mean beta R ratio higher, which is beta P by this is beta R ratio of 10 and this is beta R ratio of 0.5 or this. So, one can see if I increase the n channel device width to length ratio compared to p channel larger, my threshold point moves towards left, okay. And if it I increase the p channel device larger compared to n channel width wise, then I move towards my right. Essentially, the threshold points keep moving away from its origin. Let us say at beta r equal to 1, that is n channel equal to p channel beta, you are here, and then you move either this side or you move on this side. One can see if beta r is 10 or something or higher, a larger n channel size means strong n MOS, smaller p channel size means weak p MOS. By same argument, if I beta r ratio is 0.1 or lower, then we say you have weak n MOS and strong p MOS. So, depending on the what kind of sizing you do, this inverter threshold actually changes. What is the importance of inverter threshold? One can see from here, the inverter threshold typically for a CMOS shows very interesting value. It shows V inverter is equal to VDD plus or other beta R VTN minus VTP divided by 1 plus root beta r, where beta r is this, VTN is n channel threshold and VTP is p channel, which is negative. However, let us take an example, VDD is 2 volt, VTN is 0.6 volt, VTP is also minus 0.6 volt and let us say initially beta r is 1, case 1, then I get V inverter is equal to 2 minus 0.6 plus 0.6 minus 0.6 divided by 2 or 1 volt, which is essentially VDD by 2. So, if you have a ratio of beta r equal to 1 and VTs are same magnitude wise, then you get 50% point as inverter threshold. And that essentially means you have a good switch. This is your V 0, this is your V in, this is your VDD by 2 and this is your VDD. So, obviously, 50% of input side you have high and 50% is low. It looks more like an ideal switch, and that is what switch circuits are expecting. So, beta r equal to 1 is very good if switching inverter threshold is 50%. However, many times these sizes will be decided by the speed, since we already said the speed decides the capacitance, is decided capacitance. The optimum value of beta r will never come good for 1 equal to 1 in the case of speed requirements. However, for a good inverter threshold to get, you expect beta r to be 1, and therefore, there is a design issue which we have to worry about, because in whenever your inverter threshold moves from left to right or right to left, obviously, the noise margin are comparatively different for rising and discharge transients, and because of that, you may have a noise problem at the end of the day. So, if I go ahead, this is what I think I already said. So, maybe I repeat again, just because the figure is here, it is taken from Rebbe's book. When the input goes from initially input was high and suddenly went to 0, n channel device turns off. So, you say the switch is opened, then the p channel is fully on initially in saturation, and then in RP is varying, but initially RP is larger and then becomes smaller as you enter from saturation to non saturation. And the current starts moving from VDD towards capacitance, net capacitance, so it starts charging. So, input is from low to high, so output is from low to high. Initially it was discharged, now it is charging towards the high. So, it is called charging transient. In the case of discharge transient, the input goes from high to low suddenly. So, one can see initially this was fully charged to VDD and now low to high, and therefore, as n channel fully turns on, p channel switches off. Now, this capacitor will be fully charged to VDD voltage, actually discharges through this, and depend on this value of V out or V c, the status of transistor changes. Initially transistor is in saturation, higher resistance. So, initial transient is slower, but as the voltage falls, the transistor enters non saturation, R n becomes smaller and the capacitor then discharges faster. Now, to get a equal kind of charging and discharging, one can expect R p C L must be equal to R n C L net. R p's are not constant, but equivalently saying R p C L must be equal to R n C L, and if we can achieve this delay equal to each other, then you say propagation is universal or symmetric. Okay. So, if I want to design a propagation delay which is average of lice time and fall time, I mean TPLH and TPHL, one has to keep C L small, which of course is the ideal. If I reduce the speed, if I want to improve the speed, I must reduce the capacitance, but that is not in our hand too much. However, some parasitics can be minimized by layouts, and we must decrease the resistances R n and R p's, and to do this we must increase the size of transistor W by L. This is a very simple first order calculations. One shows that all that I have to do is to increase the size of n channel p channel. However, to maintain a good inverter threshold, I may have to adjust the ratio of beta r as well, and because of to get a good noise margin. So, there is a trade off between noise margin and the speed to some extent. So, before I move further, let me give you what we have read. So far, we have not entered the area of logical effort. Before we start the logical effort part, I just want to recapitulate whatever we did earlier or we know about in the case of dynamic response. Four terms we keep talking about. One is switching speed, which is limited by time taken to charge and discharge C L. Then we say rise time, a waveform to rise from 10% to output at the output, please remember, output waveform to rise from 10% to 90% of its steady state value is called rise time. And waveform to fall from 90% to 10% of steady state value, we call it a fall time. And then we say delay time T d, time difference between input transition and output transition is T d, average delay. And we define therefore that average delay as a propagation delay, which is sum of average of TPLH plus TPHL, and the maximum in frequency which is allowed typically by any inverter for propagation to occur is 1 upon propagation delay. Essentially, one many times a designer does not use 1 upon tau p as the maximum speed. He assumes that in his calculation of TPLH and TPHL, which are directly functions of capacitance, he has underestimated the value of capacitances. And the worst case, all parasitics and underestimation may add to, let us say, the maximum value. Maybe 4 times the capacitance which was actually there, but I estimated only one type, and therefore, the worst frequency which an inverter is can always work is one we say 1 upon 4 tau, and that is the safest system speed you can work on. But in when we are scaling down the circuits now, okay, the dimensions of the every transistor, actually we are reducing the sizes so much that the propagation delay should become higher, I mean smaller and smaller. So, if we start taking now this 1 upon 4 tau as our universal, this will be beating the something which we are trying otherwise. We are trying to improve tau p itself without actually going for C, But now you say, okay, I think that we haven't done well and make it 4 times tau, which is not fair, and therefore evaluation of tau p now is becoming very, very crucial, and essentially therefore it is becoming very important to know what is the capacitance value one has to drive and what is the current each in charge and discharge time I can provide, so that I can minimize tau p lh, tau p hl with the available capacitances which I may get, and therefore what speed a particular circuit can attain. If I do this analysis, which transient analysis I said, typically I can derive these expressions. TPLH is CL net capacitance, KP essentially is half, you know, KP by 2 is beta P, but right now we assume that 2 has been taken care, beta by 2 is K. Beta is mu c of W by L. So, we this is spice version, they say b instead of beta p by 2 or beta n by 2, they write k p and k n. So, you can see from here, this is beta p by 2 in case, and this is beta n by 2. C L upon this, which is p channel threshold, this is p channel threshold divided by this part of the charging transient low to high. You can see from here, if you see this many terms, this essentially is looking a linear kind of thing, or due to the larger resistance provided in the saturation. Whereas, if you see the second part, which shows log term, one can see from here why this log term is appearing. Log term is appearing simply because in the case of non-saturation, we have seen the current, which I may repeat, I may show you again. In the case of saturation, this is like a square law, whereas in the case of non-saturation, there is this non-linearity or some kind of a transcendental system is appearing, VDS here and VDS square, some quadratic terms appear in calculation of VDS. So, therefore, if you solve this using these current values, you will essentially get into a logarithmic solution or exponential e to the power t by tau kind of this, and therefore, this will give you a log term. So, the log term appears when the transistor is in non-saturation, and linear terms occur when there is devices in saturation. So, the first part of the TPLH and TPHL both are essentially to saturation transistor mode, and the second part, that is CL, KN, VDD, this into this is essentially to non-saturated N channel. This into this multiplied is essentially be charging due to these non-saturated p channel, and one can see from here this value is smaller than this. So, discharge transient, once you reach some value of VO lower than VDD, device will enter non-saturation and it will discharge faster. By same logic, initially it will take time to charge, but then will charge fast using exponential functions. Again, looking at the expressions of TPLH is one best method of reducing the TP, which is average of the two, is to reduce CL. You can always say if you reduce VDD, increase VDD, but if you increase VDD, the power is going to be larger, and the whole effort in VLSI is to reduce power and increase speed together. So, I cannot play, and for a given node VDD also will be given by ITRS. So, it may be 2.1, 1.5, 1.2, 1 volt, 0.8 volt, 0.6 volt. So, this is not so much in my hand also. VTs of course, are also technology dependent, depending on the node I use VDD, I have VTs fixed. So, if you look at very carefully, for a given load CL cannot be say minimized. The only thing I can improve the speed is this KP and KN, which is essentially mu COX W by L half of course, but essentially mu COX. COX is fixed for a technology, mobility of N channel or P channel is also fixed for a technology. All that I can change to improve the speed is the size of the transistor W by L. Now, therefore, the question arises, how do I optimize the delay? And that is very important, because at the end of the delay essentially means the time taken for input signal to go to the output is the delay, propagation delay. So, I want to know, how do I optimize this? Now, obviously, I have different way of two methods of doing that. I can have different gates in the circuit, a chain of gates. So, I must do properly what I say gate size selection, which kind of gates I should use and what sizing I should do for them. that is they how much current they should be able to drive. Gate size essentially is proportional to current required, and corresponding the current will provide from the transistors N channel or P channel for charging and discharge. So, I must size the transistors. Please remember, if you decide a size for your current requirements, you must believe that since W and also are directly connected to capacitances, it looks sometimes very funny that you improve in a RC time constant by scaling, you may reduce capacitance, but proportionally you may increase the resistance. So, RC should remain constant, but that is not so. So, if that is so, that means at given technology no better speed can be attained. So, to beat that system, I must now somehow find how to reduce the delay for a given logic to implement. Now, in real circuit these days, for example, most of the circuit designs are done through IPs, available IPs, which earlier we used to call standard cell design approach, in which you have a library that offers multiple drive strength of cells, that is, it can drive 1 milliamp current, 2 milliamp current, 10 milliamp current or half a milliamp current. These are pre-designed, pre-fabricated, pre-tested, and their schematics are provided with this data. Of course, they do not tell you what is the technology in and what is the value, but they will give what is the kind of schematic value, I mean at the end what is the performance values. And current synthesis tools do a very great job for gate size selection. So, that is not a big issue. The second part is the sizing of the transistor itself. Now, it is done in a custom design in which you size individual transistors during the design process to optimize delay. Now, how does it depend on? The quality depends on individual designer. Some synthesis may help, or that is available to you. Synthesizing tools are very greatly available these days. And you keep iterating, you keep simulating with iteration, a tempting option, but can be time consuming. For example, I can have million, I'm not million, say hundreds of W by L ratios and values, which I can keep substituting in a circuit and keep simulating. Of course, as the word go, there is no zero probability system. So, someday you are going to attain a speed or times you are looking for, and you say you have achieved W by L for that speed. But doing so, the window for marketing the product would have been already lost, or maybe you are 2 years behind. So, no one is going to buy your system anyway. And because of that, the speed is crux. Where to start simulation, therefore, is most crucial in starting the design. There are many algorithms for gate size selection already exist, so that is not a big issue, but and one such approach is very famous, it is called Tillo's algorithm. What I am going to talk about is Tillo's algorithm in nutshell, can compute the delay along a path of gates, have multiple gate sizes to choose from. These are two assumptions. I can define, I can get any size of, that is, any driving capabilities, 1x, 2x, 4x, 1 milliamp, 4 milliamp, 2 milliamp. I can choose the size of the gate which can allow me that currents, and I can decide the connection so that the path delay can be minimized. And this we'll choose that two of these so that you get the best delay. Here is a very simple algorithm which I am going to show you, which is essentially Tillo's algorithm. Why I am showing you all this precursor to my logical effort? Because after all these have been already done, and logical effort actually summarizes in a best way all those theorems, methods, algorithms which we know into a nutshell, which gives you a faster design. So, at the end I am looking for a faster high speed design. So, here is a step one. The kind of circuit you are shown here is you have a chain of inverters, each has a gate size such that it is called minimum gate size, which can mean minimum driving possibility, 1x, 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 1x. Now, I give an input and I measure or monitor when the V 0 receives the input, and the delay I calculate, and that delay I call last delay. Okay. That means, all of them are 1x, last this is my the this gate I solve, the final gate we say is current gate, and this earlier gate which is driving this gate is called driving gate. Now, this driving gate and this current gate, and these are right now fixed. So, input starts has come here, and from here to here for this load of CL, I evaluate the time. The time from here to here is fixed for anything, any size here as well, but time from here to here will change depending on what are the gate sizes on this. Then I take another way. I say, okay, double the size of current gate, which means it has the twice the current driving capability. This gate can now provide double the current compared to this, and it is still driven by the same size old one, which is 1x. Okay. Obviously, if I have larger gate sizes, larger currents, if this has to provide larger, double the current, the size of these transistors here or gates should be sufficiently large enough, at least double of that, so that they can provide you double the current. If the sizes on this increases, obviously the capacitance will increase, which is the output of this has to now drive larger capacitance. So, then it will get delayed here. So, we calculate the delay from gate G3 to G4 in the 2A step with 1x as the driving gate and 2x as the driven gate or current gate. Now, I repeat the same experiment, but now I say my driving gate is doubled, 2x capacity of driving, but my load current gate, which is my final gate to drive the load, is has the old value. And I again, please remember, these have not been changed. So, delay from input coming from anywhere input till this time is same for either case. Now, you have 2x here and 1x here in the earlier case, 2a case, 1x here and 2x here. So, I again monitor the delay coming from here to here in both cases. The first I case case A, and this one I call 2x x 1 I call case B. Then I compare the delays between case A and case B, okay, and compare my these new delays 1x 2x and 2x 1x with all 1x 1x case, which is called the last delay. Now, let us say the 1x 1x case has certain delay, and by making 1x 2x I get a delay which is larger than the last delay or lower than last delay, and by same argument if I make 2x 1x this kind of two statement, I also have a gate delay which I will figure out whether it is more or less than last delay. So, whichever circuit A or B gives me lower delay than the last delay, I would say I have improved. And this algorithm then tells, okay, instead of putting, let us say this is better B, and I say at least last two stages are fixed, you make 2x 1x as calculations. Now, call this as one current gate. Using this current as a gate, I actually now work with this as a driving gate and sorry. So, I say now this becomes current gate and this becomes driving gate, and I repeat this performance once again with these two. Then next time I figure out, now I have standardized this for the minimum delay, then I use this as my current gate and this as my driving gate and keep doing. But I do not tweak with the first gate, because this is essentially coming from the first, which is a fixed side input buffer, so which is fixed. So, based on the first one, I now know the size of this, because of this and these two I know the size of this, because of this I know the size of this. So, I have now made all possible gate sizing for the minimal delay. To save execution time many times, you can have, you figure out this is 1x, 2x, this is called window around. So, you have one sized gate, you now very well know such circuits will give maximum minimum delay here. So, you fix this and never use it, never redesign it again. Okay. Now, one rule of thumb for delay essentially is the larger output capacitance will be decided by how many fan outs the output has. Typically, it is suggested that at no time the output should drive more than 5. Preferably, the highest fan out normally can be used is 4, and therefore, it is called a case of FO4, fan out 4. So, all circuits are actually for a given standard load, which is called FO4. So, the maximum fan out be restricted to 4 and no more, less than 5, I would say 4. Then also, since the input capacitance changes with the fan ins, so also you must say number of fan ins should be lower. And even in for more submicrons kind of technologies, it should be less than 3. Okay. Then along a critical path, the minimum delay is achieved in each stage by delay is about equal, keep rise fall time about equal. And then before I quit today for the day, I may say before I decide how to go for transistor sizing, gate delay sizing I did, but the next part I say is transistor sizing. I would like to do, it will be great or it will be nice if I do some back of envelope calculations. Now, if I can do transistor sizing and gate sizing by very simple calculations, which will give faster response to me, then I would say I will be saving my effort. And we say Sutherland, Spaul, Harris, who actually first time talk about the new simple technique based on whatever we are asking in our earlier part, that was called as logical effort, okay, or logic effort. And they wrote such a book, which is Logic Effort Designing Fast CMOS Circuit, which introduces this method of logical effort. We will attempt to apply this method during this course to circuits that we will look into, and we will look at static CMOS applications first. Thank you for the day, and we will come back tomorrow and continue with this actual working on logical effort. Thanks for the day.